Good morning.
Good morning.
Why don't you wait till that was off? There are only two announcements. Next week is the congregational meeting right after church this year. So please stay in the sanctuary when service is over and we will conduct the meeting and there will be some snacks, I believe, afterwards. Also, there are packets for the meeting that you can pick up today. But if you pick one up today, please bring it with you next week so we don't have to print more of them. And I believe the seniors have an activity coming up this week. Does anybody want to talk about that?
Tuesday, they're making breakfast bags for Caring for Friends.
Okay, so we're making breakfast bags on Tuesday at 12 o'clock, right?
Well, start at 1 o'clock. We eat first and then we...
Oh, okay. Eating first at 12, 1 o'clock, they start making the breakfast packages for A's for Friends. All right, does anybody else have an announcement? Okay, would you please rise for the call to worship? Scripture proclaims, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?"
We gather in the presence of God. Let us open our hearts and minds now in worship.
Let us pray. Almighty God, as we stand in all of your goodness and mercy today, we invite you to be present among us by the power of your Holy Spirit. Father, we declare that we love you. Thank you that you have made the way of love known through your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray that you would reveal this great love to us all today as we gather for worship. Lead us by your Spirit to praise you. May our hearts overflow with thanksgiving and our mouths proclaim your everlasting greatness. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen. In Jesus' name, amen. The steadfast love of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. I declare to you in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, that we are forgiven.
Thanks be to God.
Let us affirm our faith together.
We believe that to be baptized in the name of Christ is to be enrolled, entered, and received into the covenant and family, and so into the inheritance of the children of God, to be cleansed also from the filthiness of sins, and to be granted the grace of God, in order to lead a new and innocent life. Baptism, therefore, calls to mind and renews the great favor God has shown to humanity. God, who is rich in mercy, freely cleanses us from our sins by the blood of his Son, and in him adopts us to be his children, and by a holy covenant joins us to himself and enriches us with various gifts that we might live a new life. Amen.
Please be seated, and let's continue our worship with praise songs.
Oh, This morning, as we continue to lift up our voices in praise using the words of Scripture, I invite you to responsibly read with me from Psalm 27. One thing I ask of the Lord, this is what I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple.
For the name of the Lord, he will keep safe in his dwelling. He will hide me in the shelter of his tabernacle and set me on a rock.
Then my head will be exalted above the enemies who surround me. At his tabernacle will I sacrifice with shouts of joy. I will sing and make music to the Lord.
Hear my voice when I call, O Lord. Be merciful to me and answer me.
This morning we're going to continue reading through the letter to the Corinthian congregation. As you may recall, we began last week with the introduction, and we're going to go through now chapter 1 and continue in this kind of being present with Paul as he tries to walk alongside the Corinthian congregation as they figure out what it is to be church, which is honestly what we are still trying to figure out today. So as we turn to Paul's words, please join me in prayer. Creator God, we come before you with humility and with an eagerness to know you more. We ask that as we hear your word read and proclaimed, that we may reflect in the presence of your Holy Spirit on what Paul has written, on the context in which he wrote it, and on how it may still have meaning to us now, so many generations later. Guide us as a congregation and as individuals to best reflect the discipleship of Jesus Christ, our desire to know you more and to honor you, and our eager participation as the family of God connected with those with whom we worship. We ask today and always that you guide us in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. So this morning we're going to continue on 1 Corinthians chapter 1, beginning with now verse 11. If you open the Pew Bible, that's on page 1128, if you'd like to read along with me. So hear these words beginning with verse 11. My brothers, some from Chloe's household have informed me that there are quarrels among you. What I mean is this. One of you says, I follow Paul. Another, I follow Apollos. Another, I follow Cephas. Still another, I follow Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Were you baptized into the name of Paul? I am thankful that I did not baptize any of you except Crispus and Gaius, so no one can say that you were baptized into my name. Yes, I also baptized the household of Stephanas, but beyond that, I don't remember if I baptized anyone else. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with words of human wisdom, lest the cross of Christ be emptied of his power. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. So as we look at this, Paul does something that I'm really bad at doing. Paul does a lot of name dropping. So I know people. I'm sure you know people. And as stories conjure up and we remember things, sometimes I go, oh, yeah, I know that person or that author or that prominent speaker or celebrity or athlete. But I know that I'm really bad and I infrequently, therefore, in my sermons and Bible studies, name drop because I'm not good at it. I know people that I'm in direct relationship with, but celebrity and notable names don't really stick in my mind. But you may remember last week we pointed out that the 1 Corinthians letter is addressed to the Corinthian church and all Christians everywhere across time and space, and is written by Paul and Sosthenes, which I'm sure you all went home and then said to your friends and neighbors, if you're going to have a baby or a new pet, I have this great new name you can use. Here's Sosthenes. I just learned all about him from Pastor Cynthia. It's this great, you know, name to honor this biblical character. Well, Paul continues in his letter, and now he does a lot of name dropping. And I had to make a list because I don't keep all these names in my head. So he talks about Chloe, who's really important to their congregation. We don't know much else about her other than she's most important because she's the first one Paul mentions. So this is some woman in the church who everyone should know. So he name drops Chloe. He talks about Apollos, who is this effective preacher? He's mentioned other times in Scripture as preaching in Ephesus and in Corinth. He mentions Cephas, which is one of the many names Peter, the devoted disciple of Jesus, has given. Cephas is understood to be his Aramaic name, so people who were of Jewish backgrounds who then converted to Christianity probably referred to him as Cephas. It's one of his many nicknames, let's say. He mentions Crispus, who we know is a synagogue ruler who's converted in the book of Acts. He mentions Gaius, which is a ridiculously common name at the time. So the name Gaius appears in the New Testament over and over again, but probably is not all the same guy. It's probably like today saying David or John or Mary. It's like a very common name. And then he mentions Stephanus, who is mentioned in Scripture, who his whole household is baptized by Paul, but we don't get the names of everybody else. So he name drops all of these people. And he talks about how he knows all of them and kind of has support and clout and power, let's say, because of his connections to them. But then turns on his head and says, even though I know all the people you know, none of that's important. It doesn't matter who baptized you. In fact, he says, I can't even remember all the people I've baptized. That's how unimportant it is, the connection between you and the person who is pastoring you, preaching to you, teaching you, baptizing you. He said, that's not the point. The point is not, well, I was baptized by Paul and you were baptized by Chloe, and that somehow makes us different. He says, no. The point is we were all baptized under the names of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. He says, that's what we were commanded to do as disciples. And then Paul, even more so maybe his humility, says, I was called to preach. But then Paul says, but I'm not even really good at that. He said, I do it, and I succeed because the Holy Spirit helps me do it. He says, but I'm really not that good at it. So Paul says, I'm not called to baptize, although sometimes I do that, but I can't even remember who I baptized. I'm primarily called to share the gospel, and I'm still struggling with figuring out what that looks like. But primarily, we know, Paul's success and enduring impact on Christianity is this relationship that he has. The fact that he planted churches, he then would stay in communities and kind of disciple and mentor those groups of people. He would encourage them to grow in their faith, and when they were ready, he would step aside and go on to the next church plant or church development and stay in contact with where he had come from. And often send letters and teachings with mutual contacts, mutual friends. This letter with Sophonies, pass this on to people and say, you trust the person who bore this letter or co-wrote this letter with me or who is with me now, housing me, therefore my words have impact to you. So he understood the value of these connections and relationships, but he said it's foolish to think there's something different about your faith based on who your preacher is, who baptized you, who's at the communion table, who's on your session, who your deacons are, who these people are. As individuals, should not change the way you express your faith. All of these people are equally capable and equally struggling, just like Paul is. He said, all of these people, no matter their name or prominence or the length of their term as a disciple in your congregation, all of them are important. And Paul says, I'm so grateful that there's other people doing this work because he realizes he is inadequate in doing it alone. But as he writes to the Corinthian church, his opening, and we spoke about last week, was their over kind of concern and the prominence of thinking that they were good at speaking and good at having book knowledge. They knew their stuff. They knew their Jewish heritage. They knew the stories of what we now call the Old Testament, and they were good at speaking. And Paul warned them that they had kind of gotten pompous about that. And by puffing out their chest about these two gifts, they were kind of pushing people away from the church who didn't feel that's where their gifting lied. So now he's saying, okay, we've gotten over the fact that you need to humble yourselves. Be grateful you're good at speaking. Be grateful you're knowledgeable. But there's other gifts out there that the church needs. And now he starts to go into his lesson that we know more fully develops in multiple writings that Paul does about the diversity of the body of Christ. That we all have gifts and they're all necessary. Multiple times in Paul's letters, he talks about the body of Christ and how the body of Christ is knit together and how, you know, your eye is no more important than your ear and your knee is no more important than your spine and your brain is no more important than your heart, all these body parts. And we've taken that language over generations and put it into our liturgy, put it into the way we set boundaries around ordination and installation for deacons, elders, and pastors, the way we work together in a committee structure, the way our polity is framed, this understanding of needing all these parts. If I were to say to you that your toe is just as important as your brain, you would probably say, no, it's not. Have you ever stubbed your toe in the dark? That affects your whole body system, okay? So it is just as important that my toe feels good than also my brain feels good, or my heart feels good, or my lungs feel good. All of these body parts have these specific purposes. And when one is injured, it affects the whole system. Or when one is ignored or not cared for properly. And Paul uses this metaphor or analogy over and over again and begins to introduce that lesson here with this diversity of the body of Christ. And he says, look at all these people I know in your church. I just rattled off, you know, 6 or 7 names of people who are sitting in your congregation who I directly know. But he said, that doesn't make any one of them better than any other person sitting amongst you. He said, all it does is create unintentional cliques. This unintentional division of saying, well, I was baptized by Chloe, therefore, you know, I've been around the church for a decade. You were only baptized by Stephanus? Well, that was 7 years ago. You're somehow less a Christian than I am. So the Corinthian church, who we lift up as this great example because there's all these letters to them in Scripture, we have to realize the reason they got so many letters is because they had so much to work on. They didn't get letters that just said, you're perfect, goodbye. They got letters that were pages and pages and pages of correction and accountability and discipleship and teaching because they had some growing edges, because they had things to work on. So first was this issue of thinking that they were better than all the other churches because they could speak well and they were intellectually blessed. And now the issue is that amongst them, there's almost a class system, a hierarchy, and they kind of put themselves in teams based on who baptized them and when. Now, many of us today were baptized as infants. I can't tell you who baptized me. I have no idea. I know it was a Lutheran pastor in New Jersey. I have no idea that individual's name is. That has had zero impact on my faith, who that person was. What has had an impact on my faith is the fact that I was baptized. The fact that I was baptized and my family participated and the congregation there, where my grandparents' church, gathered around and affirmed and supported my parents and extended family in welcoming me as a child of God into the church universal. Not that particular congregation, but into the body of Christ. Some of you may know who baptized you, but whether or not we know who it did by name, the impact was the baptism, the congregation, the ongoing commitment moving forward to surround and envelop that person, no matter their age at their baptism, to grow into their faith. In the first generation of Christianity, many people were baptized as adolescents, teenagers, adults, elderly individuals, because when Christianity is new, if you were born before the time of Jesus' resurrection, you couldn't have been pre-baptized into Christianity. You were catching up. So in this first generation or two, there's many people catching up. But for like Stephanus, his whole household was baptized. So we looked at that and say, okay, everyone of any age, any background, any gender in his household was baptized. But Paul again points out, I think I baptized some other people, but I can't even remember. So even for Paul, he can't remember the individuals he baptized. I think I have shared with you that in my 15 years as a pastor, I've only ever baptized one infant. Everyone else I've baptized has been a child, a teenager, or an adult. I've done plenty of other baptisms. Usually they happen at confirmation class time when teenagers realize, oops, I never got baptized, and we can't figure out where their faith journey started exactly. They don't have a date and time to pinpoint it, but they'll say, well, now my family goes to church and now I want to be a part of this and my family is supporting me. So when you go to seminary, they give you a baby doll to practice a baptism. They don't give you a 17-year-old boy and say, I don't practice how to do this. So many times I've baptized people who are simply on their knees because they're taller than I am to reach their head. But that amazing gift is that I can't even tell you the names of all the people I've baptized. If I sat down and saw them again and saw their name, it would jog my memory in photographs. But it's the act of inclusion and affirmation in the family of God, more so than any individual participant. And Paul is trying to help this early congregation and you and I to understand it's not about who your preacher is or who your pastor is or who your Sunday school teacher is or who's on session or who's a deacon or what role each person has at any specific time. The point is your church a healthy church? Is your congregation utilizing all the people it has and all the gifts it has in the best way it can? Yesterday, we gathered with five congregations for a training for elders and deacons who are currently serving. They were from Ronhurst, Calvary, Bethesda, Fox Chase, and our congregation. There were 31 elders and deacons there, plus four pastors. So 35 of us gathered together. And thankfully, therefore, very little leftovers after lunchtime. We did a good job on that. But as we gathered together to remind ourselves and reaffirm ourselves as those called to lead, ordained, and set apart for a special purpose in the life of the church, we thankfully mixed ourselves together and discussed the uniqueness of each one of us and our role in our congregations. And discovered that this was a room, thankfully, filled with people ranging in age from their 20s to their 80s. This was a room full of men and women, people of a diverse vocational, educational backgrounds, different social connections, and from five different unique congregations, all coming together for the purpose of affirming that we want to be the best we can in our current time and place in service to the church using the gifts that we have. It wasn't a room full of 35 identical people, and we are thankful for that. It was a room full of 35 different people who each bring different gifts and a variety of gifts and backgrounds to the way they are called to serve the church right now. And when we came together yesterday, that was unique. And the fact that that room then had 35 opinions, 35 backgrounds and histories with the church, 35 different ways of being who we are. And yet, we all together sat in one voice to praise God. We all together fellowshipped and learned. We all together were in prayer. So we were unified. Thankfully, I never heard anyone in the room say, but I'm from Elkins Park. Mm. Maybe they wanted to. But there was not this division of, this is where I'm from, and therefore it draws an uncrossable line in the sand between you and I. The overall sentiment, feeling, consensus, thankfully, in that room, engendered by those who were there, was that we are all children of God. We are all Christians called and set apart for this time in our lives and the lives of our congregations to serve. And we are working together, learning from one another, sharing ideas, lifting one another up, praying for one another. And this is exciting. And we're going to take this enthusiasm and hope back to our roles in our congregations. And when we get together again 2 years from now to do the same thing, there will be a different mixture of people in the room, hopefully, with the same enthusiasm about the gifts we can use together. So Paul looked at this early church and he said, why are you dividing yourselves? Why are you drawing lines? Why are you saying I'm Team Chloe and I'm Team Cephas and I'm Team Stephanas? Because that's who baptized me. Like there's some sort of brand or mark on you that we know, like you're wearing your team colors and there's a rivalry. He said, no. No matter who baptized you, no matter when or how you came into this congregation, no matter who you were before you became a Christian, now that we're together, we are the body of Christ. We are unified and the diversity we have is a blessing. Many of us struggle in our modern language and culture with the diversity that we see in front of us and how to articulate and affirm the differences we have without separating us. To look at each one of us and say we are unique, maybe it has to do with our educational background, our family background, our age, where we grew up, how long we've lived in this community, what kind of skills and education we have, our racial, ethnic, and religious backgrounds, all of these things come together and makes this amazingly diverse congregation here and in our neighborhood churches. But Paul's warning to the early church was, if you focus too much on those differences and make that your primary identity, you'll never feel like you're unified together as the church. He said, above all else is your identity as a baptized follower of Jesus. That is universally true about everyone in the Corinth church and everyone in the church universal now. So if you are a baptized follower of Christ, that is your primary identity above anything else. And then all of your secondary, tertiary, and et cetera identities are wonderful additions to the gifts and resources a congregation has, but none of them are more important in your identity than being a follower of Christ. But the early church needed to know this because even in that first generation, they were already dividing themselves. And that's confusing and concerning to us, but it also shows the great wisdom of Paul in addressing this letter with his friend Sophonies to this congregation and saying, this letter is not just for the Corinthian Christians. Paul and his partner in ministry say, we think this letter will have impact on every Christian across time and place. So share this information. And thankfully they did, because we still have it. Because somehow Paul had the forethought and the foreknowledge to know this might be an ongoing problem in the church for generations to come. Maybe he didn't realize 2,000 years later it might still be an issue. But he wanted to affirm this identity we all have and how that is more important than anything that could separate us. But then to celebrate that diversity by using this analogy of the human body, the fact that your hand and your foot are not the same. They have unique purposes, but you need both to be your best self. And that diversity is a gift to the church. Paul struggled with feeling that he was adequate and prepared and equipped and gifted enough to do what he was called to do. He said, I'm called to preach, but I don't think I'm very good at it. He said, I've baptized people, but certainly it's not my primary concern because I can't even remember who I baptized. Time and time again, he was put in prison. Time and time again, he had to travel in places that were dangerous. Over and again, he wanted to visit the people and longed to be with people, and he never got back to see them. His life was certainly not perfect. But he said, even in the midst of all of this, I feel called and gifted to write, to teach, to plant churches, and to remind all of you, he says, not just the people right now in Corinth, but anyone who will ever receive this letter as a follower of Christ, that the diversity of gifts we have is what the church is meant to be. It's this amazing gift that we were reminded of yesterday when we gathered with these five very different churches, that are different communities that all have different stories. That the unifying reality in that room was we were all followers of Christ, and that primary identity made us instantly be friends, whether we had known people in that room for 40 years or had met them that morning. And moving forward from that time, we now go out into the world and say, as a disciple of Jesus, I want other people to know and follow Christ. I may also have affinities for these people because of professional connections or community connections or other things we have in common. Or I may discover that I'm extraordinarily different than these people in many aspects of my life. But this unifying principle that we're followers of Christ is who we are. So Paul asks this question, does it matter who you follow? Are you gonna say, well, I'm a follower of Chloe or Stephanus or Paul, or I'm a follower of Pastor Cynthia, or I'm a follower of Billy Graham, or I'm a follower of Pastor Bruce over at Bethesda, or a follower of Pastor Timothy over at Fox Chase? These divisions don't help us. The divisions maybe help us recognize and best utilize the diversity of gifts we have. But Paul's concern was for this unity and this primary identity as baptized believers following our risen Lord and allowing that to be the primary thing we hold on to. Even if we literally forgot the rest and couldn't even remember who we were baptized by or who we may have baptized, we can't forget that when baptism happens into the body of Christ, into the family of God, into that unifying principle we have together. So I hope those of you who were with me yesterday at the presbytery office will share the joy of that experience as we fellowship together after worship today. I hope there's ongoing relationships and partnerships with other churches, but then we also identify and realize the uniqueness of who the Elkins Park congregation is and the gifts that we have here, that partnerships can add to our ministry. Partnerships can sometimes inject a little enthusiasm into our ministry, but we all have a unique purpose in our unique neighborhoods to respond with the gifts God has given us, and above all else, to testify the fact that we are followers of Christ no matter our geography or our role in the church or the time that we've served the church or even the connections we may have to multiple congregations. This amazing call to identify as a follower of Christ is what Paul has called us to, and what throughout Scripture the Holy Spirit leads us to as well. Amen. There are many ways to share our gifts and the treasures and abundance that we have with the people of God and showing honor to what God has done for us. One of those ways is with our voices, as our choir has done. Other ways are in service and leadership of our church. One way is in sharing the abundance of treasure that we have. So thank you for your continued good stewardship and contributions to the ministry and efforts of this congregation as we reach out to our community and as we cultivate faith amongst one another. This morning, please join me in prayer. Almighty God, we thank you for the many gifts this congregation has, for the calling you've placed upon servant leaders, to those you have called to lift up their voice in praise, to those who act as teachers and servants and partners and missionaries. We thank you, Lord, for the many who care for this facility, who care for our treasures, who care for our staff and volunteers, for those who reach out to our community and invite others. We ask that you continue to give us an abundance and to bless us and guide us in how to use all the blessings we have. We ask this all as joyful givers, giving thanks in the name of Christ. Amen. Another language that I know from growing up and being involved in youth ministry, Moving forward, our congregation is going to return to singing more in the worship service. That was part of your feedback to our town hall in December. So you may have noticed between last week and this week, we are singing more. We're singing more verses of hymns. If it gets to be too much, let us know as well. But we did respond to that desire to lift up our voice in song and praise more frequently in our worship time together. So thank you for that encouragement and affirmation of our choir, of our music director, and of our time of praise and worship together. If there are particular favorite hymns you have that we have kind of skipped over inadvertently recently, let myself or Therese know as well, and we will integrate that into our worship service. But this morning you may notice that several of the hymns and music we lifted up, I think, are quite familiar to us and may be considered favorites of our congregation. As we continue to worship together this morning and lift our voices in praise, we want to also lift up in prayer the concerns we have for family and friends and members of this congregation and community, as well as lift up the thanksgivings we have to God. This morning, are there prayer requests we'd like to add to our time together? I know, Betsy, you had asked for prayers for Jake, and he's continuing to seek some medical guidance.
Yes, my grandson Jake, who's at Penn State, his parents got a call that he had thrown up some blood. They did not have the test. They're still looking to find out what's going on.
So we'll continue to lift up Jake in prayer. I also know overnight I saw on the news that there was unfortunately more gun violence and other attacks and things throughout our nation, so we will continue to lift up victims of violence and those who are struggling with safety in their communities. Belinda.
My daughter Nikki has COVID again. It's not her, we're worried about her. She's okay, it's her patients. Mm-hmm. She's many immunocompromised patients, and she's so worried about this. Mm-hmm. Let's pray for the patients.
Of course, yeah, prayers for Nikki and for everyone who's a caregiver of those who are immunocompromised as we continue to deal with COVID and flu and RSV and all that we're dealing with this season. Yes. Yes, Betsy.
Here I say that since last Sunday there was a tragic murder in this neighborhood.
Yes.
So for the son of this family and the family members, certainly, it's like I even know the word they use.
You know, prayers for those residents in the Beverly Road community after that shocking news that we discovered that unfortunately someone took the lives of their own parents. Yes. We continue to pray for that community and neighborhood and the remaining family members, and of course the individual, the perpetrator of that crime, because clearly she's in need of some sort of help. Yes, Martha.
Pastor Janine at Calvary.
Mm-hmm. Yes, for Pastor Janine and her husband Peter, who recently had an illness as well. Yes. Lots of people dealing with, I know some of the presbytery staff as well, I dealt with COVID this past week, so we'll continue to pray that people stay healthy in the days ahead. Please join me in prayer. Almighty God, we come before you now almost 3 years into a pandemic, realizing that the world is still dealing with illness and pain related to that and to other realities for our human selves, the fact that our bodies are not meant to be used forever, but they are temporary gifts from you. We ask for healing for our bodies and our souls and our community. We ask that your spirit intervene in ways to bring wisdom and comfort and strength and healing. Lord, in times of doubt and fear, when we are overwhelmed with grief, we ask that you be present in our lives to give us strength. Lord, though we know when we pray for wisdom and strength that that may mean you bring us challenges and doubts so that we can learn those skills. So Lord, let us work through as disciples who are confident that you are going before us and leading us and shepherding us to something new and exciting, to something that will prepare us for whatever lies ahead so we can respond in ways that show forth your glory. Lord, we thank you for the leaders of this congregation and for the neighboring congregations that gathered together yesterday, for the enthusiasm and hope we found in owning our identities as servant leaders. Lord, we thank you for the continued mission, ministry, and outreach of this congregation as we look forward to Tuesday and creating breakfast bags to help those who are food insecure in our neighborhood. Lord, we thank you for the congregation here who worships with us in person and those who worship with us from home. We thank you for the amazing contributions of each person who uniquely is gifted and called, who has been baptized into the family of God. We thank you, Lord, for our identity as believers, and we ask that you remind us to always put ourselves in the place of a child of God before any other identity. Guide us, Lord, to embrace the connections we have with our brothers and sisters in faith, and may we move forward united in service to you, inviting others to join us and to increase the diversity of gifts and opportunities we have, to be surprised, Lord, by those you put amongst us, so that we can respond in ways that are new and exciting to ensure that all may know the good news of salvation in Jesus Christ. Lord, we ask all of this as your disciples, lifting up the prayer you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you now, if you're able, to stand with me and lift your voices in singing, Here I Am, Lord.
Thank you.
I am thankful that that call has led you here, and now I selfishly ask that you use the gifts you have here amongst these people in this time and place to lift up this shared identity we have as children of God and to celebrate the unique and multitude of gifts we have to use together in service to God here, in encouraging one another and inviting others to know the Lord as Savior. Go now from this time of worship with the blessings of God, our Creator, Jesus, our Messiah, and the knowledge of the ever-present, ever-comforting Holy Spirit. Amen.